on Unsolved Mysteries. An undercover vice officer is murdered, and a witness sees two women leaving the scene. Could they be his killers? A cab driver picks up one last fare and is later found stabbed to death. But the blood in the cab does not belong to the driver. Can the dead send messages from beyond the grave? Meet three people who say they've been contacted by someone long dead. And a violent gang pulls off more than two dozen assault-style robberies, leaving terrorized victims in their wake. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Walnut Creek, California, an affluent suburb of San Francisco. On a quiet morning, a shopping center groundskeeper notices a Corvette sitting alone in the parking lot. A man seems to be napping behind the wheel, but the man isn't asleep. He's dead.
The cause of death was determined to be two bullet wounds. This was an extremely cold-blooded, deliberate killing. The sort of person that would do something like this is extremely dangerous.
The victim is identified as Lester Garnier, an undercover vice officer with the San Francisco Police Department who lived in nearby Concord.
There was very little evidence left at the crime scene that would give us much help in identifying the criminal. We do have a few fingerprints that have not been identified, but we've been unable to find any motive at all for the killing of Les Garnier.
There were many sides to Lester Garnier. On the job, he was a dedicated police officer. But after work, he lived life in the fast lane. Why was Lester murdered? Well, the reason may lie somewhere in these contradictions.
If he was off duty, Lester was usually behind the wheel of his prized 1984 Corvette.
He enjoyed the good life, but was also devoted to his parents.
Lester was a wonderful son. He always was there for us. He gave us security, knowing that if anything happens, he's always there for us.
Those who knew him said that Lester had a reputation as a ladies' man.
Hi. That's a beautiful car.
His natural charm with women also came in handy on the job. His beat was San Francisco's Mission District, the neighborhood he was born and raised in, and an area with its share of streetwalkers. Lester often duped prostitutes by posing as a customer.
We found that he had made numerous arrests for prostitution. We certainly examined that aspect of his life, and we weren't able to find any connection with our case. We interviewed several of the prostitutes that Lester had arrested and found that many of them spoke highly of him, even though he had arrested them.
He wanted to do a good job, and the type of job that he had to make sure he made all the right moves.
Before his murder, one of Lester's final assignments was to stake out a brothel said to be patronized by civic leaders and police officers. After it was raided, Roger Boaz, a local mayoral candidate, pleaded guilty to charges of having sex there with underage prostitutes. Several police officers were also investigated, but only one was charged and later fired. Rumors circulated that corrupt members of the police force had Lester murdered in retaliation for his work in busting the ring.
We did address those issues and did a very thorough investigation, but we found no connection at all between Lester Garnier's death and the Roger Boas case or any other matter for that matter.
The evening of his death, Lester left his home to meet a friend in San Francisco.
Yeah, Steve.
Less than Lester. 20 minutes later, Lester. He called from his car with a message.
No.
During this conversation, he canceled the meeting with his friend, saying it was getting late.
Yeah, maybe some other time, okay?
After that, we don't know what happened to him until his vehicle showed up in the parking lot shortly before 11:30 p.m. That time period is very critical.
As a portion of our investigation, naturally, we searched for witnesses, and we discovered that there was a carpet layer working in one of the stores late that evening. As he went out to his truck, he heard what sounded to him like firecrackers. It was around the 4th of July, so he discounted those sounds as firecrackers. Shortly after, he looked up and saw two women walking across the parking lot. The women entered two different vehicles and left.
The witness described one of the women as being in her late 20s, about 5'6", and said she weighed about 110 pounds. The other was described as being in her mid-30s, tall, with a slender build.
We also located one witness who was actually driving through the lot. As he drove past the Corvette, he saw a woman open the passenger door and exit the vehicle. He saw her walk around the vehicle and appear to look in the driver's side of the Corvette. It's possible that these were just two separate sightings, not associated with each other. However, it's also possible that they are somehow related.
Under hypnosis, the second witness helped police create a composite drawing of the blonde-haired woman. Her appearance was similar to the other eyewitness description.
When we showed this to the carpet layer, he felt that this sketch closely resembled the shorter of the two women that he saw walking across the parking lot.
There is one other clue suggesting this woman might be involved in the murder. Police used a fingerprint found in Lester's car to identify the blonde-haired woman seen by the witness. She is a Scottish national who's lived in the United States since 1985. Although she's been named as a suspect, authorities don't have enough evidence to file charges. The mayor's office in San Francisco is offering $250,000 reward for information leading to an arrest in this case. Next, a night out at a baseball game turns tragic when a parent discovers that her 9-year-old daughter has been abducted. Alma, Arkansas. On a summer night, Colleen Nick took her 6-year-old daughter, Morgan, to a Little League baseball game.
We'd made the choice to go, just Morgan and I, just to have girls' night out. And it was just such a warm, close, fun night.
You want to come with us to catch some fireflies?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if my mom will let me.
Two local girls asked Morgan to come play with them.
Mom, can me and my friends go catch fireflies?
Oh, I don't think so, honey.
Colleen, that should be fine.
Are you sure it's safe?
Finally, against my better judgment, I told her that she could go and play. And she threw her arms around my neck, gave me a big hug.
Stay where I can see you.
She's naked.
We could see them very clearly. And then the last time that I turned to look, Morgan was running back and forth playing.
But when the game ended, the two girls returned to the field without Morgan.
Girls, where's Morgan?
Fly a car getting the sand out of her shoe.
Which car?
I don't know. Yours, I guess.
I'll be right back.
Okay. Morgan! Morgan!
I went over to the car, looked around the outside of the car, opened the doors, looked inside the car, thinking she had gotten in. Even at one point, looked under the car, just thinking she has to be here somewhere. And within a couple of minutes, all of the people and most of the cars were gone, and it was very clear that Morgan wasn't there.
Calm down. Where was the last place you saw her?
One of the coaches questioned the two girls.
Girls, look at me. When you were in the field, Were you there alone?
They remembered seeing a man whom they describe as creepy talking to Morgan out in the field.
I'm gonna go call 911, okay?
Thank you. One of the coaches had a cell phone and made the initial 911 call to law enforcement. They arrived within 6 minutes and began an immediate and massive search for Morgan that night.
But they found no trace of Morgan. The media was alerted and flyers were posted. Weeks stretched into months, and finally years, with no sign of Morgan Nick.
It's the worst terror that any parent can ever feel. There's such a sense of it not being real somehow. It does not seem possible that your child could be missing, that someone could have taken your child.
Colleen Nick turned her personal tragedy into a public crusade. She created the Morgan Nick Foundation, a nonprofit organization that assists families with missing children.
Yes, come down. We really need to
Colleen help. Has become involved in the search for a missing girl named Jacqueline Castaneda, kidnapped when she was just a newborn. By now, Jacqueline would be a young girl. Her mother still hopes to find Jacqueline, who disappeared on an otherwise ordinary spring day. Outside Phoenix, Arizona, Olivia Castaneda arrived at a swap meet with her baby.
My husband dropped me off there with my two babies, Nayeli, my two-year-old, and Jacqueline, my four-month-old baby. I took Jacqueline out of the car with her car seat, and Nayeli, I took her walking.
Before meeting her mother inside, Olivia needed to use the restroom. She finally found a portable bathroom. Finding it too cramped and dirty, she made a decision that would lead to tragedy.
Jacqueline couldn't fit inside, so I just took my two-year-old, Nayeli, inside the restroom because she could have walked away if I left her outside. I was in the restroom like for a minute. When I came out, Jacqueline wasn't there anymore.
Jacqueline! Jacqueline!
Hoping that her mother had taken the baby, Olivia rushed into the swap meet.
Mom, do you have Jacqueline? Do you have the baby? Oh my God, I lost the baby. We gotta go find her.
But I felt more upset and more nervous when I saw my mom that she was by herself. She didn't have the baby. And that's when I felt I was gonna die. I just didn't know what to do.
Hi, baby. Have you seen my baby?
After 20 minutes of searching booth to booth, the police were called. Police immediately sealed off the swap meet.
There was an officer stationed at all the exits and along the fence line. And as cars were leaving, we would check the vehicles as they left. As people were leaving the side exits through the gates, we would go ahead and check them, make sure they weren't carrying an infant or had a car carrier.
Jacqueline was not found.
Hi, this is Colleen Nick from the Morgan Nick Foundation.
Colleen heard from a national missing children's agency that a baby girl had been abducted in Arizona.
Yeah, hold on a second. Let me see if I have that.
We're able to do posters. We're able to email Jacqueline's information out to people who might not otherwise get it, and then to also counsel her family over the phone if they would like to talk to us.
Colleen traveled to Avondale, Arizona to meet Olivia.
She had her daughter stolen too, and she knows what you're feeling, and It's nicer to talk to someone that knows what you're going through.
But it wasn't your fault. Is that okay?
Yeah.
I find that's the greatest need that a family has, just to be able to look someone in the eye and to know that there are other people who haven't given up hope, to know that you're gonna survive this, that you're gonna come through this, and that hopefully your child is gonna come home. And I think that is what I try to bring to families the most, is that hope and that reassurance.
The search for Jacqueline Castaneda continues. She can be identified by a unique heart-shaped birthmark on her upper right arm. Jacqueline would now be a young girl. This computer-aged photo shows what she might look like today. The service that Colleen provides for families with missing children has not detracted from her primary goal, to find her own daughter, Morgan.
I believe and I hope every single day that I get up that today is the day that Morgan comes home. And every night when I go to bed and she's not back yet, I know that I'm one day closer to getting her back.
This is a computer-age photo of Morgan Nick, who would now be in her early 20s. She has blonde hair and blue eyes. This is a drawing of the man seen talking with Morgan. Police would like to speak with him in connection with her disappearance. Next, did television star Michael Landon send a gift to his daughter from beyond the grave? What do a Christmas ornament, $300 in cash, and the fragile red rose all have in common? Some would say they were all signs from heaven, gifts sent from beyond the grave. One by television star Michael Landon, one by grandfather Herman Stegos, and another by a college student named Joe McCarthy. A student at Notre Dame, Joe had just returned home after his freshman year when he was killed in a car accident. He was just 18 years old.
When Joe died, there's, number one, there's emptiness in your heart and in your mind. It's like, where is he? Is he okay?
I kept thinking at the time, if he could only just talk to me. Just one time. And
everyone's grieving around you, and so you're thinking, I wish I knew. It's just that thought, is he okay?
The McCarthys didn't actually expect an answer. And then 3 days after the funeral,
I was going through the basement out into the garage, and I saw the angel that tops our Christmas tree laying there. Since Joe died in June and we had the Christmas ornaments stored in an upstairs closet, I thought it was kind of strange, but didn't really think a whole lot of it.
That same day, Joe's mother also found something as she was vacuuming.
And I picked it up and I just thought, it's an ornament. And I just looked at it and I thought, this is one of the ornaments from the Christmas tree. Why is it here? And I just set it aside. I set it on a shelf we had there.
That evening, Dennis told Kathleen about the angel that he had found.
It was right there in the middle of the floor. I almost stepped on it.
You know, I found an angel today, too.
And I went and got it and showed it to him. And it said Joseph on it. He said, it's a sign, he's okay.
The McCarthys had four angel ornaments, each engraved with one of their children's names. This one had been Joe's.
I looked at it and saw Joe's name on there. It was really an incredible feeling. The fact that he gave his mother an angel and I an angel on the same day, to me, was pretty powerful.
It may seem amazing, but the McCarthy's experience is not that unusual. Dr. Louis LeGrand reports more than 50 similar experiences in his book, After Death Communication.
This happens just an innumerable amount of times. We can't explain it. Science will never be able to explain it. It's a gift to the heart, and that's what explains it.
Herman Stegos was 69 when he died just 3 weeks before Christmas. He was especially close to his oldest grandson, Anthony. Herman's apparent message arrived with the holiday mail.
Kids, present from Aunt Terry.
When this package came, it was kind of like, it was exciting for the kids because it took their mind off of, you know, the grieving. They opened up the packages, the wrapping paper was all over, the shipping stuff was all over my mother's living room floor. So I asked Anthony if he could clean it up and take the box out to the garbage.
Anthony was on his way out when he was suddenly stopped in his tracks. He says that his grandfather spoke to him.
When I heard his voice, it did freak me out, because it was scary.
He said, Mom, Pop just told me I should look under the flap of the box.
She just said, quit playing around. She thought I was playing a game, but I wasn't.
I said, Anthony, throw the box out. And I thought he was playing with me. He said, no, Mom, you don't understand. I heard him twice. He said, look under the flap, look under the flap.
Wedged in the bottom flaps of the box was an envelope.
Look, it's a card.
Inside were three $100 bills, one each for Anthony, his brother, and his sister. Beth is convinced this gift would have been lost if her father had not spoken from beyond the grave.
I think that was the biggest message in the whole thing, that, you know, Grandpa's still here, and Grandpa's still watching you, and Grandpa's spending the holidays with you, and I didn't leave, and I didn't abandon you, and this is the way that he could tell them, you know, that I'm still here, and this was a sure way of getting out his message, that you're not alone, that I'm still here with you, and I still love you.
To have had an experience of this nature, when love is rekindled, the person is able to reconnect with life again, to get some energy back, to be able to look at themselves in the mirror and say, maybe there is some meaning to what has happened.
Were the experiences of Joe's family and Herman's family just coincidences? Not if you ask Cheryl Landon, daughter of actor Michael Landon. In 1991, Michael Landon was at the height of his career. He was the star of Highway to Heaven, in which he played an angel sent to Earth to help people.
There was a warmth about him. There was this love, this spontaneity. It was like he was my angel from heaven, my father from heaven.
When Michael died of cancer at age 54, Cheryl was devastated.
It was the greatest loss of my life. My best friend, my mentor, my protector, my guidance, everything, my security, it was all gone. And I started hearing my dad's voice. My father would come to me in dreams. And I thought, boy, I must be really grieving because I'm hearing my dad's voice. I'm seeing him in my dreams.
Cheryl made a promise to carry on her father's legacy of emphasizing good deeds and good-heartedness. Her first step was writing a book called I Promised My Dad. But as the publishing deadline approached, Cheryl felt more and more nervous about the public appearances necessary to promote the book.
I remember going through so much of the emotions, and I really thought, how could I go on and do these television shows successfully? And I very clearly heard my father during the day say, when you go to do your first show, I'm gonna leave you a long stem red rose.
Finally, the day arrived. Cheryl was in New York City, nervously preparing for her first talk show appearance. She says, that's when she heard her father's voice again.
I heard his voice again, and he was right there. And this time he told me to find the fountain in Central Park.
The strange part is that I knew exactly where this fountain was, never being there before. It was like I was guided exactly to this fountain.
Maybe it is, let's go check it out.
When I had gone down to the bottom of the stairwell, there at my feet, exactly where I had stopped, was a long stem red rose.
This is just the way my father said it would be.
It was like I had discovered a treasure of gold. I was so happy. I was so full of encouragement that it was just like a boost of love, a boost of encouragement.
Cheryl's friend who witnessed the moment snapped this picture to commemorate it.
Are the grief-stricken understandably willing to clutch at anything that might bring them comfort? Or is there really something going on that is beyond explanation? For the families we've just met, their answer is simple. They held the proof in their hands.
Next, a rash of robberies by heavily armed thugs plagues a California town. Vallejo, California, north of San Francisco. During a six-month period, 29 local restaurants were robbed at gunpoint. Police believe the takeover-style robberies were committed by violent street thugs known as the Romper Room Gang.
Nobody move, nobody breathe, shut up! when the two robbers came in, they were just ordering us around, telling us to open things. If we weren't fast enough, they'd curse and yell and tell us to do it quicker. So we just gave them the stuff and hoped they'd hurry up and leave. From the time they came in to the time they left, it probably took about 2 minutes.
All right, man, I got it. Come on, let's go, man.
It was frightening, the fact that, I mean, they have guns right there. They could just kill you if they wanted to.
Some of the language they've used during the commission of these has been very specific. They've used terms such as don't make this a 187, which in California is the penal code section for murder. The pattern was fairly consistent throughout in that it involved generally two black males that would enter an establishment. They always wore masks. They're generally of the knit cotton ski mask type. Weapons have varied from handguns, revolvers, semi-automatics, to more recently, Uzi-type weapons. They've gone so far as to strike people on the side of the head with the handguns, kick them when they're down. Whether or not they're going to get more aggressive, we always fear that. We don't want to encourage giving them any opportunity to escalate that. We don't want to see anyone acting as a hero or taking them on.
I got it, man. Come on, let's go.
The robbers seemed familiar with the layout of each restaurant and went about their business with a cold efficiency. Within minutes, the thieves vanished, leaving police with almost no clues, only terrified victims. Update.
This case appears to have been solved. Several key members of the Romper Room gang were sent to prison on other charges. Once they were behind bars, the rash of assault-style restaurant robberies came to an abrupt end.
The resort town of Banff in Alberta, Canada, is nestled in the snow-capped Rocky Mountains. 21-year-old Lucie Turmel moved to Banff for its peaceful, friendly atmosphere. She soon found work as a part-time cab driver.
Lucie came here for paradise, and Banff was known as the paradise town. Everything was great for her. The people, the place, the way of life, everything was great for Lucie.
On May 17th, Lucie spent much of the evening working the downtown tourist trade. Near the end of her shift, she had taken in just over $100. Lucie arrived at the Works nightclub on Spray Avenue, hoping to pick up one last fare. There, she talked to another cab driver.
Hi, Larry, how you doing?
Hey, Lucie, not bad, yourself?
Not too bad.
Had a little conversation, at which time I had looked out my window to take a look at them. It was a gentleman and two girls.
Lieutenant Cougar, please.
Just seemed normal.
Yeah, I got a 3-4-600 Cougar from the Works.
Lucie called in her destination to the dispatcher and drove away.
I'd done a few more fares, at which time I had asked Bruce if Lucie had phoned in. And he said, no, I haven't heard from her. And this was about 12 minutes later. We started asking for her on the radio, at which time she did not answer. And after about 20 minutes, finally decided to look for her.
Larry drove to Lucie's last reported destination and then passed her house. Less than a block away, he spotted her cab, but Lucie was not driving.
And I'd asked Bruce right away, I said, are you in front of me, Bruce? And he said, no. And right away he replied, well, the guy stole in the cab. But at the same time, I had the bad feeling, you know, where was Lucie? How come she hasn't phoned us and said her cab has been stolen? And I told him, I said, well, I got the guy.
Larry tailed the stolen cab for 2 miles and cornered it on a dead-end street. He caught a brief glimpse of the driver, who then disappeared into the woods. At virtually the same time, police were responding to the report of a body lying in the middle of a street 2 miles away. Lucie Turmel was dead. She had been stabbed repeatedly in the neck.
It was the first murder that had occurred here in 20 years. There hasn't been anything like it since. And it's a shock to the people that live here. Our best information is that robbery was the motive for this murder. She had probably about $100 in taxi fares in the cab when the killing occurred, and that money is missing.
When police examined Lucie's cab, They found blood spattered on the dashboard seat and steering wheel. But lab tests came up with a surprising result. The blood wasn't Lucy's.
We're surmising that the attack on her took place outside the taxi and that the attacker somehow cut himself during the attack and bled inside the taxi while he occupied it for the 20 or 25 minutes after the offense occurred. What we don't know is whether the person who killed her was her last fare, may have been in the taxi with her and forced her to get out, or it also could have been somebody who flagged her down and dragged her out of the taxi and then stabbed her.
Hi there.
18 hours after Lucy was killed, a local resident found the murder weapon in her driveway. Police learned that it had been stolen from a hotel employee, leading them to believe that the killer may have been from out of town.
We've interviewed a lot of people. We did neighborhood inquiries. We were unable to find anybody who had seen or heard anything at the time of Lucy's death. That is kind of unusual because at that time of morning, there's usually people out on the street, but it's unfortunate, but that's what we're stuck with.
Update. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police have arrested Ryan Jason Love for the murder of Lucy Turmel. When Love first became a suspect, he refused to give police a DNA sample. Two policemen then went undercover, befriended Love, and obtained a sample of his DNA without his knowledge. When it matched blood found in the taxi, he was arrested. Love was convicted of second-degree murder for killing Lucy Turmel. He served his time and has been released. Next, the story of a young woman who overcame a traumatic past thanks to the help of a total stranger. Chicago, Illinois, July 1961. Hidden from the busy streets of the city's south side is the scene of a crime and a family betrayal. 14-year-old Kathy Williams had been forced to take part in a drunken party where she was raped by her stepfather, Clifford Starks.
I awoke in the middle of Clifford's bed with Clifford actually laying almost on top of me. He was naked. I was totally naked. I remembered his hands being all over my breast. Well, I knew that that was wrong, and I didn't know what else had happened. I couldn't remember, and so that scared me, too. And that's why I took off. I wrote the letter, and I thought that would be the end of it in a child's mind. I'm thinking, well, you know, this will take care of everything. I can get out of here. I'll be saved.
The sexual assaults continued, but Kathy Williams was faced with even more than the abusive situation at home. When she tried to get help, Kathy ran up against the influence and credibility of her stepfather. He was a detective in the Chicago Police Department.
Kathy Williams ran away from home, but her stepfather easily found her. She was beaten and locked in a room for more than a week. When she was finally let out, Kathy went to the police.
What is your name?
I don't know.
Where do you live?
Kathy decided to pretend that she had amnesia. If all went as planned, her stepfather would never know of her visit, and she would be sent somewhere else to live.
So we just had to put her down as a Jane Doe. And I'm thinking, God, good, they'll take me someplace, because anything was better than going back to that hellhole that I had run away from.
Are you having problems at home? Well, if you are having problems at home, running away is not going to solve them. Do you have brothers and sisters? If you have brothers and sisters and you are having problems, they could be going through the same thing you're going through.
So finally, Kathy chose to tell the truth and hope for the best.
My stepfather has been molesting me. He moved.
And she said, you poor child. She said, we'll do anything and everything we can to help you. Everybody was empathetic. But for some reason, I felt like this was the police. Maybe they really could help me. And I felt that I had two younger sisters there, that they didn't need to be there, and the same thing could happen to them, because I hadn't thought about that.
But Kathy's hopes were quickly shattered when her stepfather was notified.
Sergeant, Detective Clifford Starks, what brings you to the 7th?
Come to pick up my daughter.
Once Clifford came down to the police station and flipped out his badge, that was the end of me.
Kathy Williams, she's Detective Clifford Starks' daughter, and he's come to take her home.
He became omnipotent, and I became a pile of nothing.
She doesn't want to go home with you.
She doesn't want to go home with me and lock her up.
I knew if I went home with them, I was dead meat. And I refused, and upon refusal to go home with them, I was then shackled with handcuffs and thrown into the back of a paddy wagon like a common criminal and taken off to the county jail.
Kathy says that she spent one night in jail and was then sent to a city home for delinquent minors.
I don't want to go in there by myself.
4 months later, Kathy's hearing in juvenile court. Many of her friends from the neighborhood came to testify on her behalf.
Kathy Williams, would you come with me, please? I'm sorry, this is a juvenile court proceeding and is limited to the immediate members of the family. You'll have to wait out here.
Kathy Williams?
Kathy discovered that her case file had somehow disappeared. It had contained affidavits supporting her allegations of sexual abuse. Kathy suspected her stepfather had once again sabotaged the investigation.
We seem to have a blank file here.
Your Honor, this is Detective Sergeant Starks. This is Kathy's father.
The judge's decision was based solely upon the testimony of Clifford Starks that day, that moment in the courtroom.
She stays out late at night if she comes home at all. She runs with a bad group of kids.
Clifford told them that they had had all kinds of trouble with me, that I was quote-unquote an incorrigible, runaway, teenager, prostitute. In fact, said I was into drugs.
Ms. Williams, please rise. Is the order of this court that you be confined to the Illinois State Training School for Girls at Geneva until your 18th birthday?
My feelings were it was the end of the world. I didn't know I could feel that kind of pain or that much hurt. Each time you think it's bad, you just think it just couldn't get worse, but it gets worse. And when you look over at your family and friends, it's like now it's proven that I'm wrong. You know, obviously this wouldn't have happened if I wasn't bad, and maybe I did deserve this.
Kathy was placed in the custody of a Cook County deputy sheriff to be transported to reform school.
I didn't do anything wrong.
Yeah, I've heard that story before.
Alone and frightened, she told her story to the deputy.
I'm here because my stepfather was messing with me.
Your stepfather?
Yes, he was messing with me.
By the time they arrived at the reform school, the deputy was convinced that the system had made a mistake. He risked his own job by offering to help.
It's all about what you said and the way you said it makes me believe. And I'd like to check it out for you. Who was that you said you wanted me to call?
I didn't know if I could believe him or not. I mean, I had believed everybody else, and I still was on my way to Geneva. But something in my heart wanted me to believe him. It was something kind in his eyes I saw in that mirror, and I said maybe he would be the one that could do something. I didn't know. I just didn't have any idea.
John Tilly.
The unknown deputy was true to his word. 7 weeks later, Kathy was taken to the state building in downtown Chicago for an interview with a social worker.
But Kathy, I can't make any promises, but we're going to try and help you. Now, when you took that paddy wagon ride down to Geneva, you talked to the sheriff who was driving, didn't you? You gave him some names. I don't know what you said to him, but whatever it was, it must have been pretty convincing. He came over here and he talked to me.
In addition, the deputy had contacted Kathy's friends and the ones who had signed affidavits supporting Kathy's accusations against her stepfather. The deputy put them in touch with the proper authorities.
Look, from everything we've been able to find out, it looks like you're in the wrong place. You got a raw deal.
He says, looks to me like you were railroaded. He said, and according to everything I have in front of me, you were. He says, so I want you to go back there, keep your nose clean, stay out of trouble, and we'll be back in touch. And I thanked him, but knowing that, hey, this is just another bubble, and it was going to pop and float on off into the sunset like the rest.
But this time, the system worked. 2 weeks later, Kathy was released from the reformatory. Ultimately, she was declared an emancipated minor and went to live with friends in the neighborhood.
It was just like New Year's, you know, counting down for the clock. You know, it was just a very happy, happy time. I was finally getting to go home with my new mother and father and my new sister, so it was a joyous occasion.
Kathy thrived in her new family and started a church group which offers counseling to abused children. But she has never forgotten the unknown deputy who lent a helping hand when no one else would.
Every girl, I guess, in the fairy tales wants a prince on a horse or a knight in shining armor, and he'd be my knight in the paddy wagon. And if I could find him, I just want to say to him that many people reach out for help, and many are refused help. But because of the fact that I reached out to him, and he acknowledged me and gave me the help that I needed, he gave me my life. He gave not only my life, I have a healthy son who's here. I've touched other people's lives in many ways. And if it had not been for him, none of that would have happened.
Update. When this story aired, Cook County Deputy Sheriff Fred Lyle was watching. He recalled meeting the desperate young girl 30 years earlier.
I just wanted to see her and tell her thank you for finding me. Because it did something to me inside. To know that somebody somewhere down the line appreciated some of the things I did for them.
At their reunion, Kathy was finally able to thank the man that she credits with saving her life.
I can't say it enough times. He was my hero. I reached out one more time, I thought. And he reached back. And here's my light. And here's my rainbow. That's what I've been waiting to give you. And another one, too. 30 years. Okay, 30.